Hi, everyone. My name is Emily Simoness. I'm the founder and executive director of Space on Ryder Farm, which is a residency program for artists and activists housed on a working organic farm that has been in the same family since 1795. It's in Brewster, New York, and we are now entering our eighth season of supporting artists and activists. We support about 150 a year. And what I am thinking about is analog, because we were housed in a 1795 homestead, which, you know, that can feel when using technology that we're going quite against the grain of what our surroundings are telling us. So thinking a lot about that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Katie Liberman. I'm the managing director of the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival. We are in our 32nd season this summer, and we'll open for audiences on the grounds of Boscobel House and Gardens in Garrison, New York on June 7th, so I hope to see many of you there. This summer season, we're doing five plays in repertory: Richard II, The Taming of the Shrew, a brand new adaptation of the Robin Hood story called The Heart of Robin Hood, as well as a new adaptation of the Rip Van Winkle story called Rip Van Winkle, or Cut the Old Moon into Stars, and a show for kids and families called The Sea Maid's Music, which will come up at the end of the summer. We also have year-round education programs. We're in 60 schools throughout the region in the tri-state area, including here in Westchester, and also have a new community engagement program, which we might talk about a little today, called Full Circle. And what I'm talking about, or thinking about right now, is those cultural consumers who think about some activities that are not for them, or this is not for me, and why that might be.
Thank you.
Anthony. Good morning. I'm Anthony Davidowitz. I'm Deputy Director of Operations at Storm King Art Center. For those of you who don't know, Storm King is a 500-acre sculpture park in Orange County. We welcome over 200,000 people a year, having experienced quite rapid growth over the last 7 years. We've just opened this last Saturday, this wonderfully rainy Saturday, our annual exhibition, Indicators, Artists on Climate Change, which is a 17-artist show, indoors and outdoors, where we've got artists who have given their own take, artistic take, on climate change and what it means to them and what it means to our site and our region. It is worth visiting. It is a fabulous show. And what I am thinking about after this morning's discussion is being authentic.
Thank you. Jeff.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jeff Haydon. I'm the CEO for Caramoor Center for Music and the Arts, about 20 minutes up the road in Katona, New York. It's a 90-acre estate, not 500-acre estate, so who's counting? 90-acre historic estate in the Italianate style of gardens and historic home and music. And music informs everything that we do. Most everyone knows us as a summer music festival, which we are and we're very proud of, but we also have a lot of year-round programming in one of the most gorgeous indoor spaces in the living room of Walter and Lucy Rosen that conveniently seats about 180 people of your closest friends. So I am thinking a lot about what the future of a performance experience might be in 10 years and 20 years from now.
Thank you. So one of the things I've been struck by this morning, it started actually when I said good morning to Jeff, and we were in the lobby looking at slides from all of these organizations up on our box office screen, and made the sort of cliched comment that all of their slides are so green and ours is not. But as I, yeah, we have a green roof. But as I think about where the presentation this morning started and this expanded definition of culture, those images from all of your organizations are very resonant about some of the things that are particular to culture in the Hudson Valley. And I wonder if we could start the conversation, if anybody has a comment about that expanded definition of culture, how it impacts your organization in particular, or how you see it alive in our region. Does anybody have a thought about that?
I'll start. I started at Caramoor about 5.5 years ago, and one of the things that struck me about Caramoor was the opportunity for an expanded sense of a cultural experience. You know, it's not just come and hear a performance or a concert, but here is an incredible sandbox, a 90-acre sandbox that you can really play in and figure out what is the relationship between music and the gardens and a historic house with Renaissance objects and commissioned works and a theremin. What is that? You know, all these different things. And then you can also infuse some of the other sort of softer cultural elements that we talked about today of, you know, food and social and learning something. And so these are all ingredients into, I think, a soup that we're all making together. And I love, you know, the interplay between these organizations, because I see some of our staff up there and we'll say, well, how does Storm King create more of that outdoor experience? Because we're not the experts at that. But then we'll get calls from other organizations, well, how do you create the performance experience? So these are interesting conversations, I think, for all of us to have together.
Katie.
When I read that in the deck, we saw the deck earlier, and when I read the piece about expanded sort of cultural experiences, my first instinct was that, you know, a rising tide raises all boats. And so for all of us up here, you know, the fact that there are these four significant cultural institutions in this area, we know our audiences overlap. I know some of my audiences go to the Burns Festival, they go to Caramoor, but they also will stop at a wine and chocolate festival on their way to the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival, or they're coming up for agrotourism or to go on a hike, and they consider that a part of their cultural experience. And, you know, as people are coming to the Hudson Valley, and we hear so many people, whether they're in New York City or Connecticut, talking about coming to visit the Hudson Valley for whatever reason, the more cultural activities that the Hudson Valley has to offer, it's actually beneficial to all of us, because hopefully they'll also consider us as a part of their visit here, and we'll see all those audience members joining us and participating in what we have to offer.
Yeah, I really thank you, Katie, for that comment, because I think a lot of times we, you know, in that expanded definition of culture, one of the key phrases is, you know, traditional definitions and non-traditional. And I do think in terms of cultural leadership and arts management, for a long time there's been a tradition of every man or woman for herself, right? And we think about our institution, we think about the silos maybe within our institutions, but we don't spend a lot of time thinking about how our institutions are silos. But for our communities, they are not. And I was trying to think about what is a metaphor or a parallel I would draw. And, you know, I know that many people spend a lot of time on the weekends here, not so much tourists, but residents, thinking about hiking and which trail they're going to walk. And none of us would say there are too many hiking trails. They're all in competition with each other. Now, I know that's a little bit oversimplified, because there are the complexities of loyalty and philanthropy across our communities as well. But I think it's really valuable for us all to be thinking holistically about what we all, as a consortium of organizations, offer our communities, and certainly the real estate agents in our community think about all of us as part of their pitch. And a really important part of the kind of livability scales that our communities achieve. And it does. I wholeheartedly believe in the rising tide description. So any other thoughts on this, Emily?
Yeah, I'm just going to add, because we're on a working organic farm, there is sort of a built-in agriculture operation that is happening at space, and I feel like that really informs explicitly and implicitly what's happening with the artists that are in residence, who are our primary constituents. But there's something, and we're mining it more every day, about the intersection between ag and art, and how those the process of agriculture is actually very similar to the creative process. And our meals on the farm for our residents are grounded in 3 communal meals daily. And so that's a huge place to mine in the way of culture. And we're always looking at ways to lengthen and widen that, so that we're, you know, the notion that, do I belong here? Is this a place for me? Food is a huge entry point, we're learning, for that, to either feel included or to feel excluded. And so we have a chef cohort that comes up for 5 months that's cooking, and we've been having a lot of deep dive conversations about how food and convening together over meals can really either bring us closer to the goal of equity and inclusion or really move us farther away from it.
That's a lot to think about. Thank you. Anthony, did you have a comment? Or it looked like you were about.
No, Rasha. I think the food is really important. When I saw this survey a few years ago, there was outrage at the person I was sharing with that food was even part of it. I've been thinking, the other thing maybe all morning is that I want a banner above us that sort of says, culture is dead, long live culture. because it does, it evolves. I can't remember the definition of culture off the top of my head, but it's art and individual human endeavor commonly held to be cultural. So it is this idea of commonality. It's we define what culture is, and what the definition of culture was 400 years ago is profoundly different from what it is now. And I think that I'm thinking of those sublime moments of food truck bliss, the lobster roll that changes your concept of what a lobster roll is. I want to do that with friends. I want to do that. And I'm gonna Instagram it. It's going to be part of my cultural output. Food unites people, and I think the way that food unites people now is cultural. So I think, you know, as you said, yes, we're getting together, and we, certainly Storm King has done it, talking about, you do this better, or how can we do this better together? How can we be better providers of our service, of our mission, of culture to the community? I think it's really important, that collaboration, that cross institutional knowledge is critical to providing whatever the commonly held concept of culture now is.
And sometimes challenging or disrupting it just a little bit. Yeah. I wonder, skipping around, the other thing I've been thinking a lot about is that both the word fun and the how that seems to me to go hand in hand with this idea of looking for outlets to deal with stress. And one of the things I found is, even in our the Q&A earlier and digging deeper into the study, is that fun isn't disconnected from learning or impact or grappling with things that are tough. And I think that's the same for the stress piece of it. It's not so much, it seemed to me that people want to have blinders on, but they want a community through which to explore the things that maybe are troubling or anxiety producing. And I wonder if any of you had any thoughts on those notions.
I'd love to take that one.
Okay.
I agree with a lot of the data and what you're talking about, and that just in talking to thousands of people that come to Caramoor over the last couple of years, I do hear that comment of how wonderful it is to have a place to be able to come and refresh my soul. Something like that. And there was this great discovery moment a couple years ago where we found this booklet that the founder of Caramoor ended up writing in 1968. We, you know, at least those of us who currently work at Caramoor had never seen this before, and it's sort of like opening scripture or something. But there was this line in here that says, basically, you know, they built Caramoor to escape the machinations of political and economic society, to inspire oneself to think more deeply and to care more deeply. That's a very bad paraphrase, but, you know, that was really inspiring, I think, to all of us. And we realized, wow, you know, there's, if any of you know Simon Sinek, there's a why. You know, it's not to, you know, and in that case, you're not making fun as a theme park. You know, you're using inspiration as the opportunity to refresh and to create fun. So then you kind of look at everything through that lens and say, okay, what meets that threshold and what falls short of that threshold? And I think, you know, even one of the things that we started seeing was just really tackling the visitor experience and saying, we've got this great artistic product, but gee, maybe we should fix the crumbling stucco, or maybe we should invest more in food, or, you know, find all those things, because even as inspiring as that artistic moment is, those other things can quickly pull that away and you forget about that. And that goes into the logistics that were mentioned on the slide as well.
We think about actually the idea of having fun a lot at the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival, because our middle name is Shakespeare, which many people think does not sound like fun. And I hope all of you in the room think it sounds like fun. We at the, you know, at the office certainly think that seeing Shakespeare and reading Shakespeare and telling Shakespeare stories is fun. But it is a bit of a marketing challenge about how do we make new audiences, young families, people who haven't been to the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival before, haven't been to see a Shakespeare play before, feel like it will be a positive experience, that it is for you, that it is for, we talk about how Shakespeare is for everyone. But that word in our middle name, Shakespeare, can be a real turnoff. And we think about how do we make it fun, and we're lucky that, as Jeff was sort of talking about the whole experience, you know, it's fun to come and sit on the grounds outdoors and look at the Hudson River and have a beautiful dinner. And it's fun to come and sit under a 540-seat open-air tent to watch a play. And if we can get people in for some of those other fun aspects of having wine on the lawn, and then they'll sit and watch Richard II and actually discover that watching Richard II in some ways can be fun. And I do mean that, but also I find it fun. But you know, in addition to fun, some of the feedback was about experiencing culture because it makes you think differently. And certainly we know that, you know, no matter what side of the aisle you're on, seeing a deposed king on stage will make you think differently about your leadership. And so you might come for the fun dinner and stay to think differently based on the content that we have later. But that having fun is a challenge for us that we think about every day.
We have a family residency at Space, so we bring working parents and their kids so that the parents have time to work on their creative pursuits. The kids have somewhat of a camp-like experience. And then the families come together for meals and to sleep. But the kids have informed me a lot about what is fun, because I spend most of my time with adult artists and how they interface with the farm, and to see, you know, we have a half mile of lake frontage, and we have sheep, which are very fun, and other animals, etc. But sort of taking my cues from them and infusing sort of how they're comporting themselves on those 130 acres and how I can offer some of what I see them do to our adult constituents has been interesting. I would also say, you know, our main programming really is curating residency weeks, you know, curating 12 people at a time that are coming from very different places with very, very different perspectives, and crossing my fingers that I have curated it in a way that will be fun. And that doesn't always mean like rollicking. You know, it means challenging. It means, oh my gosh, I never thought about that. It means, oh my gosh, I never would have met you had we not been in this place together, and now we're having this conversation, and that might lead to some collision or conversation or collaboration in the future. So for me, sort of the curation of groups of people is rich and fun.
Thank you. How do those experiences, that visitor experience that many of you have talked about, or maybe, Emily, the resident experience, although it might not be exactly parallel, but how does that translate into this idea of loyalty or relationship building? Maybe that's a bigger word to think about. And how do your teams think about that as you plan?
Without fun, one can't properly engage. Without proper engagement, one can't properly educate. Without proper engagement, one can't properly develop loyalty. And so going back to what I've been thinking about this morning, this concept of being authentic. Mm. One of our co-founders was renowned for wandering around anyone he would come across, whether it was a guest or a member of staff or a trustee, and saying, "Are you having fun?" That it became almost his catchphrase. And as annoying as that may sometimes be, if you are not having fun, then you're not engaged. The way that we engage people is by showing beautiful greenery. It's by showing people enjoying our site, by kids learning, by telling our members not support us for the sake of supporting us or because you did before, but because this year we are doing this much more, or this year you can have these new experiences. So I think that's whole idea of fun and experience and being authentic to yourself and to your mission and to your supporters is what encourages loyalty.
I don't know how many people know the Broadway director, Tina Landau. She is directing SpongeBob SquarePants right now, which I've yet to see, but I've heard is great. But I heard her give a TEDx about how when she's looking for the theater that she wants her Broadway play to be in, she's really looking not only at the interior, but like, what does the exterior look like? What does the walk to the theater look like? Like, how the experience starts before the experience starts, right? And I think about that a lot. One of our core values is radical hospitality. And I really believe in that. I really believe that taking care of people and making people feel like they were thought of sets the stage for loyalty. And for feeling like, oh, you thought of me. And one of the ways we do that at Space is that we have a crazy collection of old mugs. And if you're in residence, I have a label maker, which I love. And I put your name on a mug. And it's a very small gesture, but it's a gesture that people talk about all the time. And I'm not offering that everyone in this audience should go do that. But what I am offering is that we really take care to make people feel like they've been thought of. And I think that when they feel safe, and you know, we call Space your artistic home away from home. We happen to be in two old homes. There is something about that that is authentic, and that allows people to be disarmed in a way that I feel lends itself to a conversation and a dialogue that perhaps wouldn't happen otherwise.
That's great. I have one more question, and then we'll throw it out to the audience. We're anxious to have be in conversation with everybody here. But I know in different forms, each of our organizations have programs or projects that nurture or support emerging artists or emerging arts managers. And I wonder how you view that commitment to the next generation as we think about questions of, do I belong here? Is this place relevant to me? Why is that? Why are you committed to that kind of nurturing? And what are the challenges around it?
I'm happy to speak to that. At the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival, we have a number of different programs for sort of training the next generation. In fact, it's called Next Gen. And sort of encompasses what we call our conservatory company, which is young actors who are either just out of a graduate program or undergraduate who come to us and act in our performances in what on Broadway might be called a chorus role or sort of on our stage, but also then are in training. They do vocal classes, physical work with teachers that we bring in from New York City, and they also create their own production at the end of the year. This year it's the Sea Maids Music, which I mentioned earlier. In addition to that, we have a technical intern program training theater technicians, and then an administrative intern program. So these, you know, we've got about 20 young people from about 18 to 30 who are with us all summer long. And I'll say the first thing that we really think about is this for me, and sometimes we think about a Shakespeare for me, is thinking about representation. And we heard a little bit about that earlier, and ensuring that in bringing in the folks who are participating in this program, we have a really diverse group of participants, a diverse group of actors, a diverse group of technicians and administrators who are representing, whether that's geographically because we house them in the Hudson Valley, whether that's ethnically or gender-wise, to all different ways that they are sort of a wide representation of who you might see on stage anywhere in the world. And we keep that idea of representation also with regards to our staff and our professional actors, but in particular in working with this training program is how do we make this place for me, both as our audiences see people who are like them on stage, but also to engage a new generation of Shakespearean actors or theater technicians and arts administrators is through representation.
I view that as, the artist development as even connected with your previous question as well, is just, it's what are the relationships that you're building, you know, within your staff, within the board, within your audience, and with the artistic community. And, you know, I think each one of us has some form of an artist training program that has, you know, great successes with it. And to me, you know, there's the individual, you know, silo program where great, you know, you can work directly with an artist and help them hone their skills. But I think the magic really starts to happen is when you start to connect those relationships to the different silos. So how do you connect that budding artist to the audience member that may or may not know about them? And you have developed the trust and the brand of the organization where the audience feels comfortable trying something that they may not know, or, you know, the board getting excited about a new initiative that's connected, you know, with a new artist. And so to me, that's where the magic happens, is all of us have that opportunity to make those connections for each other.
Yeah, I would agree. Emily?
I would just add, it's really important to us that our intern cohort, and then we also have a greenhouse residency, which is for emerging playwrights, so folks who have not had any production, and that those cohorts, as well as our entire resident cohort, is incredibly heterogeneous. And the reason for that is that, you know, in the first years it was more homogenous in all the ways we think about homogenous. And I felt like, you know, for me, the marker is watching the dining room conversation, which is a funny marker, but it's mine. And I found that the conversations were the same. You know, they weren't bad conversations, they were just similar conversations. And that when you bring together a more heterogeneous cohort, you get more vibrant, interesting, deeper, richer conversations. And so I feel like it's not only, I mean, I feel like it's my responsibility to be bringing those groups of people together, because that is the world that we live in. And if I have the opportunity to do that in my tiny little farm in Putnam County, then perhaps that notion will ripple outward, right? That what happens there does not stay there, that it ripples outward, and hopefully someday soon it's a better world. Here's hoping. And that I'll underline that it's our responsibility.
And I'm going to interject a little plug, because you for space, if you'll excuse me, if you have not been to a seasonal supper or a dinner at Space, there are opportunities for the public to enjoy Space on Ryder Farm. And to be part of the vibrant dinner table conversation. So I encourage you to look at their website and go to a dinner. My husband and I are still talking about a dinner we went to a couple of years ago and tracking the plays that we heard pieces of there. And that just speaks to, Jeff, what you were saying about that those networks, those new intersections between artists and audiences, between arts leaders and audiences, are really, really important. And it just goes back to the top of this conversation about breaking bread together is a tremendously powerful way to form those relationships. So that's literally happening at Space, and it's very exciting to be part of. And so now to the you all.
Hi, thank you. My name's Stephanie Lin. I'm with the Sing Sing Prison Museum, which isn't opened yet, and we're maybe in a slightly different category than some of the cultural things that you've discussed. But I've been thinking while you were talking a lot about fun and the stress component, but also the breaking bread also ties into crying together in my mind, the flip side of fun, because I was reading recently how the show This Is Us has like sob fests that everyone has online, and I am just curious about how you can not be manipulative, but perhaps create loyalty through emotion that's not always fun, and you know how much thought you've given to that. And because crying in a group is very communal and is something that makes you feel connected. So anyway, it's just something.
Maybe I can jump in there, because if you know Jacob Burns' programming, you know that we often show things that aren't fun and are and produce tears. I shouldn't be flip about that, I apologize. But we have the series that jumps to mind is a series called Global Watch, which is a very important series that we're very committed to here. And we're looking through primarily documentary films at big, huge, scary, and uncomfortable issues that have global as well as local impact. And we also do that through a series that's very has very locally oriented conversation called Community Matters. That isn't always a sob fest, but is meant to be provocative. So I do think that any kind of emotion, wherever, whatever flavor, can be a catalyst to bringing us together. What we try to do here around that is have conversation and dialogue like this afterwards. We heard a little bit, I think, Maggie, didn't you? You spoke about the post-cultural experience piece. It's sort of like Tina Landau, the experience starts before the experience and it extends beyond the experience. So we try to make formal space for that here. And informal space is just as important. One of the next questions for our organization is that idea of our informal spaces, and how do we make them available for relationship building that maybe we're not the direct catalyst for, but people find themselves upstairs having coffee after something together, and there's the informal sort of our version of a third space. So I think that begins to get at it. I think all of us would probably talk about, I have two sets of feelings, kind of the digital and analog, about, you know, Netflix and television as a collective experience. And maybe through social media, there is a This Is Us sob fest that feels somehow collective. But I don't think any of us would do the jobs that we do if we didn't believe in this literal sharing of space. And so there, I can tell you from experience here and elsewhere that people want to have those profound experiences. And I think when we look at, you know, culture transforms perspective, it builds community. It's a place for public education, was that the third category, or educates the public, and builds empathy. And so when you're looking at those as drivers, fun takes on a whole other dimension. And I think organizations that fall into the kinds of community and social justice issues that I know you all are talking about at the museum, it would hit all four of those points. That's a long-winded answer, but that's what it makes me think about. Yeah.
I would also just say that can I just say one thing? I feel like safety needs to underpin the whole thing.
Right, that's a good point.
And we have a whole week that's dedicated to those working in the social justice space, and we support a lot of activists. And we have a great time, but there's also a lot of sadness. And those things are sort of two sides of the same coin, I think. But we have to feel safe to feel both of those things. And so what does safety look like for your organization? That sounds so like, I don't mean like crossing guard, but you know what I mean.
Hi, I'm Laura Schrader. I'm from culturalpursuit.com. It's a member-supported organization, so I'm coming at this from the consumer, the arts consumer. We travel from Tarrytown in small groups to Fairfield, Connecticut, cover both counties. So I've been to just about all of these places. and fun is a really simplistic word. I had a few others: memorable, transcendent, and enriching. Mm. And it goes with educational, but the cross-pollination is really, really important. And you know, I see so much great programming, just everything within an hour of Stamford to White Plains. So, you know, my hat's off to everybody for being so creative, and thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Jennifer. I'm from the Thomas Cole site, and I was shocked to see the environment was so low on the list of kind of causes that people care about. And we at this, I don't know if you know, Thomas Cole was a Hudson River School artist, and he had a pretty strong environmental message, and we've really embraced that and incorporated it into the educational programming and the exhibitions. And we also thought or think that it's also kind of a good cause and kind of almost hook for donors of all levels, from individuals up to foundations. And I'm wondering if, you know, maybe that's a national response, but do you feel that people here in this area care more, and maybe specifically about Storm King and your climate change exhibition? I don't want to think that's true for our community. I don't know.
Gosh, it's like I set that question up. Do I, okay, hear the entire statement. Do I think that people want to give to the environment or care particularly more about it here? No, absolutely not. I like that there are synonyms for fun, but fun's actually a great word, because fun covers many different things to many different people, whether it's experiential, whether it is, I can have a fun and cathartic experience and it can still be fun. I think the environment, nature, is really hard. It is such a broad thing that means so much to so many people. Like modern and contemporary art, I think from a funding perspective, from an experiential perspective, you've just got to find the way into certain audiences. One of the things that Storm King always, one of our mission is art in nature. And you can't concentrate on either one more than the other, because you lose our authenticity. If you are going after a certain group, find what in nature or environment you want them to be engaged in, whether it's flowering trees or goats that clear native grasses or wildflowers. These are all ways in to tell the bigger picture. But you talk about climate change, you talk about environment, you talk about nature, they're big and scary and esoteric and a bit sciencey and really a lot of the time not fun. So I think, don't be disheartened, because I think that when people say, I'm not really gonna give to the environment, they might be giving to Greenpeace or WWF because they like elephants. And it happens that saving the environment or saving ecological systems is a byproduct of that. We have recently started to concentrate on supporting trees. You're not supporting a single tree, you're supporting the concept of planting trees. And then we can tell you why planting trees is good. We can tell you about soil erosion if we want to, or we can tell you about shelter, and we can tell you about the sub-ecosystems that are created by large specimen trees. So that I wouldn't be disheartened.
Question over here.
Yeah.
Hi, I wanted to talk about space as this precious resource, not just space and art farm, but it strikes me that four of you have these wonderful facilities or grounds that you put to use, and the Shakespeare Festival gets to use an amazing ground facility, but you also move programming around. So I wonder if maybe Katie could talk about how she finds spaces to put to use, and the other four of you can talk about how you welcome other organizations and their programming.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you, Zach. I set you up too. For those who don't know, we perform on the grounds of the Basketball House and Gardens, where we've been now for
31 of our 32 seasons, but we also take performances on tour throughout the tri-state region, including Space and Storm King. So we've been to some of the venues that some of the folks who are here with me on stage. And something that we often, we're looking to go anywhere. I mean, we really think about, as I spoke about Shakespeare being our middle name, our first name is the Hudson Valley, and how do we ensure that we, our mission is, part of our mission is to engage the widest possible audience in a fresh conversation about Shakespeare's plays. So how do we reach that widest possible audience? It's not sitting on the same grounds for the same 4 months during the year, but throughout the year going to all different venues. And so we think about location, we think about reaching new audiences. We also know because we perform in an outdoor tent, we can go anywhere. So we can perform in a barn when it's raining or just right outside on the field at Space or truly outside next to a piece of art on the grounds of Storm King. We've gone to Bannerman's Island in the Hudson River, but we also will go to a public park in White Plains, and we'll go to the Hudson River Museum in Yonkers. So we think both geographically, we think about diversity, and we think not as much about really the technical aspects of the venue, but how can the venue and the art speak to each other in one way or another. Certainly because we've learned in the way that we perform with the backdrop of the Hudson River that the space does inform the work that we do. And we know from our own research of our audience, audiences come in addition to see the show, but to experience that space. So what are the other beautiful venues in the Hudson Valley that we can ensure our work has touched in one way or another? So thanks, Zach.
The other side of it?
Remind me the other side of the question.
The folks with spaces, how they welcome.
So we have a whole institutional residency program. So institutions, predominantly theater institutions, but this year we have folks like TCG and Steppenwolf and The Roundabout and Katie coming. It's just her. It's just a one. It's a single option. No, I'm kidding. But they can come for day-long strategic planning retreats. They can come for a weekend-long. Some of them send up some of their commissions to be worked on, as well as workshops. So that is how we are sort of supporting other institutions. And then I would say one other sort of way in which we're serving institutions or sort of the community is we have a CSA. Is everyone familiar with the CSA, Community Supported Agriculture? There's a group in Minneapolis called Springboard for the Arts, which has community supported art, which you're aware of. And so one of the things that we're looking to roll out more predominantly in the next few years is not only that Ryder Farm is a place to get your veggies, but it's a place to get your art. And so sort of looking at what is the meld of those two things, it's predominantly been used for visual arts organizations. You get a box of art, and in doing that, you support those visual artists, but we're more performing arts-based, so we're trying to figure out what that looks like.
That's cool. I would say, you know, we're looking at all kinds of collaborative and programming and cross-pollination opportunities, so how can we use our spaces in new and interesting ways? And have had conversations with lots of folks up here about that. We're talking most specifically at the moment with Caramoor about what we might program together. But then there's our less formal and sort of less literal sharing of space collaborations. We have been working with Ryder Farm, who's interested in what does a residency look like for film artists, because it's a different way of working in many cases. Unless you're a screenwriter, then it's natural to be looking at the needs of screenwriters and playwrights. But beyond that, what might we do? So we've been in conversation, we've visited each other's spaces, we've had made wish lists, that kind of thing, and so there's that kind of less literal, but a lot of thinking, sharing thinking spaces. And that's really, you know, as you all know, it's really valuable to get you out of here and out to there.
Yes, hi, I'm Sarah Rogers. I'm a librarian at Dobbs Ferry Public Library, part of the Westchester Library System. I've attended events at all
of your events, of all of your organizations, with the exception of Ryder Space and Brewster, which sounds lovely. And I also support your organizations by putting up your flyers and your brochures that
thank
you send
you.
Out.
Thank you.
Yeah,
and
thank
I'm
you.
Happy to do so, and I get ideas for myself and my family. But I heard the statistic this morning that one of the barriers is to culture is that the value is not worth it. So what I'm curious about is if you can talk about how you can reach an audience that may not be able to afford your fees.
You make them free for us.
We also have about four. This summer we'll have six free performances during the summer that we advertise, but also all season long. There's seats in our tent, our theater venue, which we refer as the tent, that are $10. Our lowest seat is $10 only, and then they certainly go up from there. But we ensure that every night, all season long, there's a $10 ticket.
Yeah, I mean, community engagement. We sponsor, or a very generous donor has allowed free access for almost all of our school groups now. That has seen a huge increase in the number of kids that can come to Storm King. Free days, community free days. The idea of access is incredibly important to our mission. It's important to reaching communities who might otherwise not be able to come to Storm King. I'm assuming we're all thinking the same thing. How do you share this experience with people?
Ditto, everybody.
Yeah. And I would just say there's one step before that. Also just outreach and awareness, because access for access sake is great, but if you're not actually reaching the communities you want to be reaching, then it doesn't really matter. And so I think we've really sort of spent the last 3 years identifying who we want to be able to partake in our programs and then voraciously, vigorously going after those communities.
And I would just add that idea of access is the breadth is great, but as Emily is alluding to, the depth is really important. So, and the experience once you invite folks in who've never been there before is critically important. And so one of my takeaways from the presentation is thinking about that kind of the connection. And what's a deep connection or a connection of valuable is not of value is not the same for everybody who comes through your doors. So it's interesting to think about what a social media follow-up might really be meaningful to a certain segment of the folks that are coming here for the first time or the second or the third time. And that's a sort of new way for me thinking about those, you know, Twitter mentions or tags or whatever they might be. But then that's not to say that the analog connection isn't equally important in a different setting. And opening your doors is really just one small part of building those relationships, and that it's got to be relationship. At the end of the day, it's experience and relationship driven.
Just I wanted to say one more thing about that, which is that we've also discovered that it's not only ticket pricing that's a barrier to access, but transportation, particularly
yes,
in the Hudson
yeah.
Valley. And we saw one of the other sort of barriers to entry was about it's too complicated. You know, we think about people getting there and the experience being from when you leave your house. So one of the challenges we are always trying to figure out is how to make that not all of us are as easily accessible on the train as Jacob Fern Center, and so how to make that last step from the train station, which I know Caramoor has figured out beautifully, convenient and accessible and easy and affordable, and even about parking or gas, because the whole evening is expensive, not just your ticket.
Yeah, and you know, we're so lucky, so fortunate with our location, but as you, those of you who use Metro North daily also know that is, it's accessible physically, but not necessarily economically. So, you know, we do the same kinds of things in our education programs. We raise money for the bus transportation. And we have, you know, we have jobs here for young people. We are a big provider of first-time employment. And one of the things we think about a lot is the fact that those opportunities aren't necessarily equitable, because getting to the job site, there's a huge barrier there. So as much as we would like
to have a broader cross section of the county and beyond represented in our house staff. That transportation to get to work here is challenging for some folks. And so there are layers and layers of issues around equity, opportunity, and access. We talk a lot about that. Jeff and I have talked a lot about, in terms of staff, access to affordable housing. This is not a county that is known for that. And it's a real barrier to employment in our organizations.
Hi, my name is Emma. I'm with Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival, so this is not a question for Katie. But we find ourselves as we approach our season having more literal conversations with people over social media. Social media is a very powerful tool for us and for all of you, and clearly very important to a certain subset of the population who feel that they're being loyal via social media. But social media can also be sort of a dark place and a place where you have to continuously kind of manage negativity or massage negativity. I wonder if any of the other organizations can talk about their marketing strategy in relation to direct communication with patrons over Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, whatever it may be.
It's challenging. It's like the Wild West out there. And I think we're in the midst of figuring out how people are using it. Like, I feel like I'm realizing it as it's happening and having meetings with my team daily, if not weekly, about like, oh, that thing popped up. Oh, okay, so then how are we gonna, like, what's our approach? So that's a comment. I feel like for us, it's about getting back to our values, living our values. And if we feel like we're getting criticism about the way in which we're comporting ourselves, then we have to take that very seriously and we have to respond very seriously. And then figure out whether that's best to do on the platform or off the platform with whoever is airing those grievances. But it feels like every day I'm seeing more and more dust that's getting kicked up. Not particularly about space, just about people's feelings about institutions, about the climate, et cetera. So I don't exactly have an answer, just to say, like, I feel you, and I'm not exactly sure how to wade through it, but we're trying.
Anybody else?
Well, now that social media is being used to set foreign policy, I think we've all got to take
it's true.
Notice of it. I think that the key to primarily positive interactions on social media is being kind, being truthful, and being honest to yourself and the person you're dealing with. I think that's it, quite honestly. Because if you're not, social media can be a very dark place very quickly. And if you maintain an honest, truthful, higher ground where you're engaging with people as people, what we have found in the very few, thankfully few, moments where people have come and tried to start something digitally, we've actually found that people have come to our support online and said, you know, you're putting this out of context, or you're not right, you're just trolling. And that when that first happened, it was remarkably satisfying, because it meant that we had developed a loyal army who believed in our brand and our mission, both in the real world and online.
Final question over here.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Alex from Caramoor. We spoke earlier about cultural promiscuity. How do we, as a region, as a conglomerate of cultural entities, promote this experience, this multifaceted cultural experience, without getting hyper-competitive with each other, without vying for audiences? Like we said, no one's talking about competition between hiking trails, but, you know, there are only so many hours in the day, there are only so many weekends in the year. How do we promote cultural promiscuity without being competitive?
Even those from Caramoor, I'm going to take that. I didn't answer Emma's question. She also worked with Caramoor, too. I mean, I think one thing I'd just sort of put out, just sort of generally, is I love the idea in the slides of relevance. And so I would sort of take that next step as connectivity. And just as Edie has alluded to, you know, having all of us in dialogues, and you don't have to, you know, have the title of, you know, CEO or vice president or director. I mean, at all these different levels, I mean, I see our staff is great about reaching out to other organizations as well. And just find those connections with what each one of us is doing. Laura, I know you do that with all of your tours as well. And so I think that's just sort of an encouragement for all of us to say, you know, yes, we work really hard to prepare our brochure and to go to our event, you know, to go to our events, but how about go to each other's events and make sure that we are having that dialogue to, you know, make sure we're talking 2 years in advance and saying, wow, we can see this great connection with an artist that's coming up there, you know, to be able to come down here, because I think, you know, we need to lead by example. So now I'm going to let someone else.
I feel like I have
Natasha Caputo.
Go, Natasha.
Westchester Tourism.
So I head up Westchester County Tourism and Film, but I also work with all of the counties with Hudson Valley Tourism. And how we, I just feel travel and tourism, when you talk about these motivators for and redefining culture, that is happening in travel and tourism. And we, Hudson Valley Tourism, is considered the 10 counties, and we work with I Love New York. It is something that we're constantly talking about with very limited dollars, like yourselves. But one of the things for us as a team is to reach out to us, and because we're only as good as you in the content that you're producing and building, that we can then go out and promote and kind of create different channels. And take into account that a visitor, we talked about the experience and the engagement and that memorable takeaway. They will forever be an ambassador to the region, and we are part of a bigger region outside of our county. So I guess, I don't know if it's more of a comment that there is a lot to be said. Our visitors are coming far and wide. We're seeing a lot more on the international front with the Norwegian and our partnership with Port Authority, Stewart Airport up there. But every single one is a voice box because of social media. And for all of our marketing campaigns, we're constantly trying to retarget and re-engage and look at them as influencers for potential economic impact for all of us and potential membership for you all.
Well, maybe that's a lovely segue into a focus for a future gathering.
Yes.
That it would be terrific to come together and to dig deeper into that collaborative approach and to sort of tap into the idea of cultural promiscuity as an opportunity for us as a network, as a group of people. Would be interesting to try to workshop that maybe. And yeah, okay, so we'll make the plan. Stay tuned. So I'd like to thank all of you for being here today. I'd like to thank our panelists and LaPlaca Cohen and Tom and Denise for pulling all of this together. Thank you.